Hello and welcome for the last time from Davos. It's a fifth day and the last interview here. And the interview is with our Davos veteran. Since 1993, our chairman, Paul Achleitner, is here in Davos year by year. Mr. Chairman, what are you taking away from Davos this year?
Well, I think one would have to be blind and deaf not to take the whole topic of sustainability away from here, which obviously has been the dominating topic, to my degree almost too dominating, because it was overshadowing other very critical issues that we need to discuss and that we are all confronted with, such as the increasing tech confrontation between China and the US and its implications for the rest of the world, including, of course, Europe. Having said that, I think that the sustainability discussion was very helpful, and I think it opens up a great many of opportunities, also particularly for Deutsche Bank.
We heard that yesterday Larry Fink was on the panel with you here in Davos in our Deutsche Bank space, and one of the things is a lack of sustainable assets, a lack of ESG assets, and we are the one who could produce them.
Yes, we do, because we have all the elements, okay, in-house, and we can bring them to bear. Furthermore, I actually would like to remind everybody that we have been talking about European capital markets union for a long time, and very few things have happened in that direction. I would actually submit to you that this is a serious opportunity that European financial institutions, and of course us as we view ourselves as the preeminent European, continental European financial institution, we could actually build up green finance as a competitive advantage for the European capital markets, and we as a player can take a leading role here.
Talk a little bit more about Europe. Europe is a little bit the problem we have, that people are deeply worried about it. It's sidelined. It looks like it's somehow squashed between China and the United States.
Yeah, I think that's a way too simplistic view. I think you could actually make an argument that Europe has very significant advantages in the world that we go, because it's not only a question of who invents the technology, but it's also a question who applies it the best way into our societies and adapts it accordingly. And if you look at Europe, Europe has very well-educated population. Europe actually has, frankly, the demographic capabilities were issues that we face may be an advantage going forward. Europe has a very high quality of life, and digitalization means that work will travel to where people want to live. People in Silicon Valley talk about basic income. We de facto have that through the social security systems that you actually see in Europe. And, frankly, maybe the political fragmentation that we have may be an advantage, because we will not have these bipolar outcomes in elections that you have seen in the UK or in the US, because those people who are afraid of the future actually get fragmented between the left and the right, and you have a much broader buffer. And for every Orban, you have a Macron. And therefore, I think anybody who gives up on Europe does there at their own risk, because on the contrary, I would say we have very good opportunities to prevail in the future.
Paul, you've been in Davos since 1993. Where do you put Davos today? You are also part of the Bilderberg Convention, and you are part of circles all over the world. Where is Davos today? It seems to be a real big spectacle. On the one hand, on the other hand, it's extremely efficient.
Well, I think you just gave the answer. I think there is always a lot of criticism, but frankly, a lot of the criticism comes from people who are not part of it. It is the most efficient way to really meet important people in a very effective time. And if you organize yourself well, it's very good. Having said that, there are also these odd different type of things that you can actually go to that are outside the mainstream if you want to, which are always enriching.
For example?
For example, talking to a archaeologist, okay, who actually writes also books at the same time of how he actually distinguishes between archaeology and fiction. Talking about a whole range of young people who have actually undertaking new initiatives, okay, not just on the environmental front, but also in other projects in terms of inclusivity and other things, which, you know, you don't normally interact. You read about it, but you actually meet people.
Talking about media, Paul, we almost were not in the media all this week, but at the end of the week, Sigmar Gabriel, our former vice chancellor and foreign policy minister, is now our new member of the supervisory board. How comes?
Well, it tells you and shows that we're not only talking about it, we're doing it. We're talking here about being in the middle of society to deal with environmental challenges, geopolitical challenges. That we're talking, here comes an individual who is a rounded and accomplished individual who has seen politics domestically, globally, who understands something about environmental policies, who has been an economics minister, who sat on the board of KfW, the largest bank and financial institution for the German government. And I am convinced that he will, in a very effective way, complement the skills in terms of banking, risk, finance, technology that we already have on our supervisory board, and I'm very much looking forward to working with him.
Was it difficult to get him and to convince our Qatari shareholders to get him on board?
Nothing is ever easy, but the results is what counts.
Thank you, Paul. Get home well. This was our last interview from Davos. After a whole week of fascinating sessions, of great interactions, of many, many client meetings here in Davos, thank you for having joined us. It was great to be here, and it was a great experience, and I hope you enjoyed watching our films. Thanks a lot, and goodbye.